Who's being mean to Ted Cruz? Let's play Hardball. Good evening. I'm Chris Matthews in Washington. Let me get started tonight with this emerging war in the Republican Party. The insurgent Confederate Party of Ted Cruz and the Northern Mainstream Party personified by Chris Christie's. When you look at Cruz, you can see the insurgent right in all its indignant victimhood. He complains of the Washington establishment being mean to him as if he were an 8-year-old in a recess yard. Like others who offered himself up as populist leaders, he presents himself as the one who's been wronged. He speaks of challenging the bosses, even though they're his party's elected leaders, and he or any other Republican senator is free to run against them. He speaks of folks saying mean things about him as if he wasn't the one who brought the government to a shutdown and nearly over the fiscal cliff. But who are the people who rallied to the Texas senator believing what is so obviously not true, that he's the innocent? He's the casual bystander in this war, when he, Ted Cruz, is the very figure who fired on Fort Sumter, not the other way around. Or is the hard right so dizzy in its anger right now that it can't get when it can't tell up from down or north from south or victim from troublemaker? John Favreau was a speechwriter for President Obama. He's now a columnist with The Daily Beast. And John Fury's a Republican strategist. Gentlemen, I want to go inside with you, sir, and the Republican Party, because you really know it. This is your home turf.
Absolutely.
It's an interesting party because it's made up of the party we grew up with, moderate to conservative, Barry Goldwater all the way over the other way to maybe John Lindsay, if you want to include everybody. Now it has a new wing. Who's winning?
Well, I think the establishment wing, if you want to say it, is not winning. They are taking on some more water. They've got to fight back in the primaries. They've got to be able to make these members honest so they don't keep on going to the right. The most important thing for the Republican
Party. Why was everybody afraid to challenge the hard right during the government shutdown in the last 2 weeks? So afraid that they stayed in line until they got the permission slip from the speaker. It's okay now to vote the way you think.
Well, they were worried about a primary. And, you know, most members are risk averse. They would rather not have a primary. And they're also worried about there's a populism going on in the country, not just with the Republicans, but also with the Democrats. There's a disgust with Washington. There's a disgust with New York. There's a Acela corridor. And I understand that. And Republicans have
what's
to
the New York problem? The old one?
It's Wall Street.
Wall Street.
The people
are big business. The Andy Jackson attitude. Yeah.
Absolutely. There's this big disparity in wealth between the Acela corridor and the rest of the country. And people are frustrated. They're frustrated where the country's going. And we appreciate that.
Have you looked out the window on the Acela and seen all that poverty out there driving through North Philly? It's not all rich up there.
Well, I know it's not all rich, but you get my point. And the sense that there's this populism out there, Republicans have to understand that, but they have to channel it into a governing philosophy. And being against everything, being that nihilistic, is no way to govern.
You say nihilistic the way I do. Do you say it that way?
Or
do you
say nihilistic?
Is this generational, or you're not properly schooled?
Let's go to the same school.
I know, but not in high school when you learn how to speak. Let's talk about this, though. John, you've been writing for the president. You're a loyalist to the president, right? Mm-hmm. Put your cards on the table. He's looking after the White House right now, and he sees the other party. They're not in disarray. Republicans are an organized group of people. But there is an unusual division going on where you can actually see across the Mason-Dixon line. It's almost the South is very much insurgent right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, and I said this in my column, I think we have to be on the side of the moderates, because I think if the president wants to be working with John Boehner, he has to make sure that when he makes a deal with John Boehner, that he's going to have some Republicans come along with him, and he's not going to have a bunch of people who
have you seen him do a good job of that? I see a good job of sitting down with John Boehner in private, keeping the conversation secret, working together, trying to peel him away from the right wing. Do you think he's done a good job of that?
I think the two men get along really well.
Has he done a good job
of that? Yeah, of course he has.
How come every time something is said at the White House, like I can't stand looking at you, or they overran me, it leaks within hours?
Because that's Washington.
That's happening. Yeah, I might, and in all due respect to John, I think that the president would like to see the Republicans go over the edge, and I think he eggs them on, because he wants the Democrats to take over the control of the House and have the whole run of the thing in the last 2 years of his presidency. I think that's a mistake.
You think he's going that far ahead?
I think he has, yes.
And I think sometimes he's fighting for survival. Anyway, the Republican Party's conflicted about how much focus it should place on social issues. This is an old question. Abortion, gay marriage, opposition to both. Well, after the election, the RNC put out an autopsy, as we know. This is after last year, arguing it needs to be more welcoming and inclusive on issues like marriage equality. But a new report out today from a social conservative group blamed the party's losses last year on the fact that too many Republicans called a truce on those issues. Quote, "We believe the conventional explanation emerging from the Republican National Committee's autopsy report gets the core issues exactly wrong. Social issues, especially the life issues, do not hurt GOP candidates. They help them win elections. The group also faulted the party's economic messages focused too much on job creators. In other words, business leaders, not regular people who have to get a job. Do you agree with that? Which is right.
There was a lot of good stuff in that report. I think we are the pro-life party, the new report, a lot. We are the pro-life party. And I think that on economics, we can't be the boss party. We got to be the worker party. We got to be the worker bees because there's a lot more worker bees than boss.
So you're with Rick Santorum.
I think Rick Santorum and Mike Huckabee have been right on this, that there is an economic populism and we have to understand it and we have to come up with a philosophy that's not just free market unbridled, let the rich be richer, let the poor be poor, that we have to understand that there is a place for helping people. And I think Santorum was right on that.
The sophisticated liberal will always tell you, well, on social issues, I'm liberal, but on the fiscal issues, I'm rather conservative. Right. But you're saying that the real angle is probably the other way around, looking out for the working class guy like Santorum and also being culturally conservative on issues like abortion and same-sex marriage. Do you agree with that? Where's the action? Where's the emerging majority in the country?
I agree with John that the economic stuff they had in that report was much more compelling. I mean, look, they're not going to run away from their position on social
issues. How about on the
social
issues? I
think they can't run away from their position on social issues. I think they have to run away from candidates like Todd Akin, who's talking about legitimate rape. That's what they have to run away from on social issues. Economic issues, there are legitimate concerns about income inequality and wage differential and job security. And, you know, I mean, one of the things in the report, $5,000 scholarship for community college, like Democrats.
Can a Republican win the presidency next time? Forget if it's Hillary or not. Forget the names. If he or she runs on the platform of hostility to legal abortion, hostility to same-sex marriage, can they win? Well, you just said they could.
Not nationally.
You just said they can't run away from their positions.
I think they can. I don't think it's the deciding issue.
Let's get it straight. Do you believe they can keep that in their platform?
I think it depends on their economic issue.
No, their platform. Should they keep the culture?
They're going to keep it in their platform.
But you said they can't win if they have them in their platform.
I think that they can't run away from the issues.
Can
but
they
I think
win
that,
on it?
I think voters decide
listen,
on economic
listen,
issues.
George
voters
Bush,
will decide on pocketbook issues.
So,
but
so,
they
it
will still,
so it doesn't matter if they keep them?
No, it doesn't matter if they keep them.
George Bush won on that platform. The fact of the matter is you can't run away on the pro-life thing, but you also can't scare people. Like, you know, Cuccinelli on contraception. I mean, we have to have a thing. There's consensus
you mean
on
those,
abortion.
You mean those unmarried women in Northern Virginia came to Washington to work, might be a little scared off by somebody who wants to outlaw birth control?
You need to focus on the issue
okay,
at hand.
I'm being teasing here because it's absurdity anyway. Anyway, former Congressman Steve LaTourette of Ohio is heading up a new super PAC called Defending Main Street that is actually trying to take on the Tea Party and promote moderate Republican candidates next year. He told the National Journal, quote, hopefully we'll go into 8 to 10 races and beat the snot out of them. Boy, he's tough. We're going to be very aggressive. We're going to get in their faces. Well, when you say you're going to knock the snot out of some, you're already pulling their punches, it seems to me. We don't usually talk like that, John, do we, in speech writing? I'm going to knock the snot out of that guy. He's a little rougher, a little rougher. Do you think that's going to work, from your view?
I hope the Republicans are going to take on the hard right? I hope for the sake of the country it works. Because, you know, we can't afford to see what we did the last couple of weeks.
Listen, what you need to have are Republicans who believe in governance. I don't think that having the big business sector coming in saying that this is our candidate, but you need to fund the candidates who believe in rational governance and come up with a strategy to do that. And the other thing about some of these candidates, these Ron Paul candidates, you know, I like Rand Paul, but Ron Paul is going through this libertarianism that is just not Republicanism. And I think that we need to find those business candidates who can rationally make the case for governance.
Well, here's one guy that thinks it's going to be hard to take on the hard right. His name is Rob Jesmer. He's the former executive director of the National Republican Senatorial Committee. He said, quote, this conflict could be the new normal. Until we have a nominee people can rally around in 2016, I think we're going to be in the wilderness for a while. Now, here's my sense, both of you. I think he's smart. This guy, I don't know him, but he's a staff guy like we used to be.
Right.
He says, basically, that until the Republican Party goes head-to-head in their day of reckoning, when they pick the candidate to run against Hillary, probably, that's when we'll know whether it's going to be a party of the hard right, a la Ted Cruz, or back to the more center-right. Do you agree with him?
There is no single dominant strain of conservatism. It's all regional. It's all based on, you know, your own beliefs. And until there's a presidential candidate that sorts it all out and we get behind somebody, we're going to have this conflict. I think Jesmer's exactly
right. Don't you fear that as a Republican that you might go into the field in 2016, an election you guys ought to be competitive in, because no party holds the White House more than 8 years easily. It's always a struggle. And you find yourself with the middle taken away from you because Hillary Clinton has moved to the center, where she sort of is already on foreign policy, and you guys are stuck with a hard right candidate, like Rand Paul or even Ted Cruz.
I don't think we're going to have a hard right candidate. I think we're going to have a governor. I think it's going to be someone who's actually rationally governed, someone who actually has made hard decisions and can understand how this all works together. And I think that
Scott Walker you're talking about.
I think John Kasich. I think if you're going to
really?
Have, I like John Kasich.
Well, I do too. But I don't think he's in running for the presidency.
But this debate is not unhealthy because there is this shift in the country. The whole idea of free market, unbridled capitalism is not as popular.
Well, here's another moderate Republican. A friend of mine, Tom Ridge, the former Republican governor of Pennsylvania, addressed the Log Cabin Republicans, the group made up of gay Republicans, last night, and he had a stark warning for his party. Here he is. For many observers, the GOP has become intolerant, judgmental, and self-righteous, perhaps worthy of the attitudes of the Pilgrims in 1620, but hardly attractive qualities for a political party nearly 400 years later. Sadly, there's a very little room, there is very little room, or respect for differences of opinion on social issues. Is the Democratic Party lucky, fortunate, in having as its opposite a party which is basically outmoded in terms of social issues?
I think outmoded in social issues, it makes them lucky, but also the fact that they're outmoded in economic issues right now. I mean, we were talking about the economic argument in 2012 is what sank the Republican Party.
It was 47% thing.
Yeah, the 47% and the idea of,
well,
you know,
Mitt Romney looked like an elitist. Let's face it,
that,
the guy's face helped, said, I've made money.
That helped as well.
And you'll never make as much.
Mitt Romney was the richest candidate we've ever put forward in history, and rich people are actually very unpopular. So it was not good
timing. That was odd for your party, because the Democratic Party has always been the party of the very high, the Roosevelts, the Kennedys, the Stevens, and people like that, and the working guy. And your party's always been the party, that's your party. I'm sorry, your party's always been a party of the bourgeoisie, the middle.
Well, this is why I think John's right. That's why we lost. It was on economic issues. And, you know, people didn't necessarily trust Romney on social issues. The hardcore conservatives didn't really like Romney, and they didn't come out to vote for him because he was equivocal on abortion.
How's the president doing?
He's great.
Is he happy?
He is happy.
Is he?
He is.
Is he happy?
He's realistic about what he has to deal
with.
What's
the biggest thing he wants to do before he leaves office?
I think he wants to get immigration reform done. And there's, you know, bipartisan bill that passed the Senate. I think he should get it done.
Really?
We'll see.
Yeah, will he get immigration reform through?
I certainly hope so. Maybe I think there's a good chance.
The less he talks about immigration reform, the better the chance we get it passed.
I think it's going to have to be a congressional fight. It's going to be very closely run. And they better be enforcing. They better be in a mood to enforce, because if they do another Simpson Mazzoli, I'll be against it. Thank you. I will. I'm not for another joke.
Yeah.
We pass a law, we ought to believe in it, believe it's progressive, and be proud to enforce it, or don't put your name on it, and don't vote for it. Thank you, John Fury. Thank you, John Favreau. Coming up.